Welcome to the 29th lecture in the course Engineering Electromagnetics. In this lecture, we continue our discussion on rectangular waveguides, which was initiated yesterday, and we talk about the TM-MN modes and then go on to discuss the TE-MN modes. First, we have a quick recapitulation of what we did in the last lecture. We are considering the rectangular waveguide shown here, consisting of perfectly conducting walls located at x equal to 0, x equal to a, and y equal to 0, and y equal to b. To find out the properties of the wave types supported by such a structure, we first wrote for the interior of this waveguide the Maxwell's equations, expanded these Maxwell's equations in the Cartesian coordinate system, and then assuming that the wave propagates along the z direction, we simplified these by substituting for del by del z the factor minus gamma bar. Then these equations were further ordered by expressing the transverse field components in terms of the longitudinal field components, that is x, y components were expressed in terms of the z components. And then we were able to make out that we may either have TE type of solution or TM type of solution. We considered first the transverse magnetic type of solution, where Hz is 0 and Ez is non-zero, and we obtained the following solution for the Z component of the magnetic Z component of the electric field, that is C sin of m pi by a times x sin of n pi by b y e to the power minus gamma bar z. The indices m and n decide the order of the particular mode, and therefore this becomes one of the field components for the transverse magnetic modes, and we call these TM MN modes. The first subscript m indicates the order of variation along the x direction, and the second subscript n indicates the order of variation along the y direction. We can now complete the field expressions for the TM MN modes, and for the sake of brevity, we rewrite Ez in terms of the constants A and B, so that it becomes C times sin of AX sin of BX, sorry, times sin of AY e to the power minus gamma bar z. Then using the expressions for the transverse field components, which are available in terms of the z components, here Hz is 0 and we have expression for Ez available, and therefore we can find out the expressions for all the remaining four field components. The steps are fairly straightforward, and therefore we can write down the field expressions straight away. We get Ex equal to minus gamma bar C by H squared, then B cos BX and sin AY e to the power minus gamma bar Z. then E y comes out to be minus gamma bar C by H squared A times sine of B x and cosine of A y e to the power minus gamma bar z. H x comes out to be j omega epsilon by H squared times C and then A sin B x cosine A y e to the power minus gamma bar z, and finally H y comes out to be minus j omega epsilon by H squared times C and then B times cosine of B x sine of A y e to the power minus gamma bar z. This is the complete set of fields for the transverse magnetic modes with order m and n. One can make out from these expressions and recalling that B is equal to m pi by A and A is equal to n pi by B, that the lowest value of m or n which is required so that these field components do not all become 0 is m equal to 1 and n equal to 1. If either of these becomes 0, the way A and B appear in these expressions, the entire set of fields becomes 0, it vanishes. Okay? So, from this point of view we make this observation, and it will play an important role later on, that the lowest order TM mode is TM 1 1, where m is equal to 1 and n is also equal to 1. Neither of these can become 0. If that happens, then the entire set of fields vanishes. Okay? That becomes a trivial situation, and therefore, for a non-trivial situation we must have both m and n non-zero, and then the lowest values possible are 1 1 each. So, TM 1 1 is the lowest order TM transverse magnetic mode. Before we discuss the properties of the transverse magnetic waves, let us also complete the a similar exercise for the transverse electric modes. And we proceed in a manner similar to what we did for the transverse magnetic modes. For the transverse electric modes, the electric field is completely transverse to the direction of propagation, and therefore, we have E z equal to 0 and of course, H z not equal to 0. Once again, if both become 0, then the entire set of fields vanishes, which is not a situation of interest. So, we will consider the component of the wave equation for the magnetic field which involves the z component, the H z component, and then using the method of variable separation we will obtain a solution for H z. Alright, I think we can write down the solution straight away since the steps are completely in parallel. and therefore HZ naught, okay, the part that varies with respect to x and y turns out to be C 1 cosine of B x plus C 2 sine of B x into the second part is C 3 cosine of A y plus C 4 sine of A y. By using the method of variable separation, we can reach this stage by following the steps previously described for the TM modes. Now the question comes, how do we apply the boundary conditions? Because HZ is not a field component, is not a tangential field component to the perfectly conducting walls, okay, and therefore we calculate the field components, the electric field components in terms of HZ, which are tangential to the perfectly conducting walls. For example, we can calculate using the expressions for the transverse fields in terms of the longitudinal fields Ex and Ey, okay. Ez is 0, and in terms of Hz we can write their expressions, and Ex and Ey are going to be tangential to the corresponding perfectly conducting walls. So, on Ex and Ey we can apply the boundary conditions that the tangential electric field component on a perfect conductor must become 0. So, in this manner we apply the boundary conditions, and we write for Ex, or to be more precise for Ex naught, we write minus j omega mu by h squared times del h z naught by del y, and as you can make out, the superscript naught stands for the fact that we have removed the factor e to the power minus gamma bar z, because that is common on both sides. All right, and similarly we have E y naught equal to j omega mu by h squared and del h z naught by del x. All right, del h z naught we have just written, and therefore these expressions for E y naught and E x naught can be obtained. Carrying out this procedure, E y naught will come out to be j omega mu by h squared, and then b times the derivative of this first part, and the second part is not going to be affected because it is the x derivative which is involved, and therefore we write here minus C 1 sine of B x plus C 2 cosine of B x, and this part we write as capital Y, okay, because before reaching this step one would have written H z naught equal to x times y, and as a solution of the wave equation x comes out this and y comes out this, and y is not getting affected in this operation, therefore we retain it as it is, which should be 0 wherever it is tangential to the perfectly conducting boundary walls of the waveguide, that is at x equal to 0, which implies that C 2 should be 0. Similarly, it should be 0 at x equal to a, and as before that implies a particular value of b, that is b equal to m pi by a. So, in this manner we have evaluated C 2 and we have got a definite value for the constant capital B. Similarly, taking care of the other part, that is E x naught, we get E x naught equal to minus j omega mu h squared, and here the first part, that is capital X, is not getting affected and therefore, we retain that as such. And the second part gives us a times minus c 3 sine of a y plus c 4 cosine of a y, which is tangential to the other two walls of the four walls of the rectangular waveguide, and therefore, we can get some more information about the remaining parameters. It should be 0 at y equal to 0, implying that C 4 should be 0, and similarly, it should be 0 at y equal to b, giving us a certain value of capital A, which is n pi by b, where m and n are integers taking on values 1, 2, 3, of course. Whether they can take on the values 0 or not, we shall discuss in a moment. All right. So, based on this, we now have an expression for h z naught, which can be substituted in the expression in the expressions for the transverse field components, and then one will get the complete set of fields for the TM modes. So, carrying out this procedure, we get H z, the complete expression for H z, as equal to a constant C, where we have clubbed C 1 and C 3 together, C times cosine of B x and cosine of A y, and of course, e to the power minus gamma bar z, okay, which becomes the starting point for the field expressions for the TE modes, and depending on the values m and n, it becomes the TE mn mode. So, for a TE mn mode, the z component of the magnetic field comes out like this, and then using the expressions for the transverse field components in terms of the longitudinal field components, E z is 0 and H z is now available. So, we can get the remaining four transverse field components, and we write down these field expressions as follows. We have E x equal to j omega mu c by h squared a times cosine b x sine of E y e to the power minus gamma bar z. E y comes out to be minus j omega mu c by h squared b times sin b x and cosine a y e to the power minus gamma bar z. H x comes out to be gamma bar c by h squared b sin b x cosine a y e to the power minus gamma bar z, and finally h y comes out to be gamma bar c by h squared a times cosine b x sin a y e to the power minus gamma bar z. A very high degree of symmetry is obvious in these field expressions, and h x and e y behave in a similar manner as far as the x and y variations are concerned, and e x and h y behave in a similar manner, okay, which will have a bearing on the wave impedance which we shall calculate later on. And of course, all field components vary along the z direction as e to the power minus gamma bar z, corresponding to our assumption that the wave is propagating with the propagation constant gamma bar in the z direction. One can look at these field expressions more closely and make sure that each field component satisfies any boundary conditions that are applicable on that particular field component. So, it becomes a consistent set of field equations which satisfy of course Maxwell's equations and also the boundary conditions which are applicable in this case. And since E z is 0, it is a TEMN mode field set. Like we identified for the TMMN modes, what is the lowest value the indices m or n can take? And then it turns out that any one of m or n can take on value 0, and as long as the other one is non-zero, the entire field set does not become 0. We will still have sufficient field components remaining to satisfy the Maxwell's equations even if one of m or n index becomes 0, and therefore, we identify this fact that the lowest order TE mode is, okay, and right now we are not very sure, but what we can say is that it is either TE 10, it is not TE 10, it is TE 10, or TE 01. And if you recall the interpretation of these subscripts, this would mean that the fields are constant with respect to y, the order of variation is 0, and they have the first order of variation along the x direction, one maximum between the x equal to 0 to x equal to a conducting walls. And similarly, one can interpret these two indices. All right. With this observation, now we are ready to consider the properties which are common to both transverse magnetic and transverse electric modes. So, let us go on to do that next. TEMN and TM TEMN modes. And what about the TEM mode, transverse electric and magnetic mode? We identified very clearly that for the cylindrical waveguides that we are considering or the hollow metal waveguides that we are considering, the transverse electric and magnetic mode cannot be supported. In fact, that becomes the distinguishing feature between the transmission lines and the other waveguides in general. Okay? We say that a structure which can support a transverse electric and magnetic mode of wave propagation is a transmission line, and structures which do not support this are called waveguides. Okay? Although all structures that we have been considering will support propagating waves, but we say that the transmission lines support TEM mode of propagation and waveguides do not. Here we have considered one particular type of waveguides, the cylindrical waveguides or the hollow metal waveguides. There are possibilities for other types of waveguides as well. For example, dielectric slab or dielectric rod. In fact, an optical fiber is also a waveguide operating at very high frequencies. Okay? All these other waveguides, waveguides other than transmission lines, do not support TEM mode of propagation. So, that becomes a distinguishing feature between transmission lines and other waveguiding structures. And now, let us see what is the significance of this observation, or what are the properties associated with non-TEM, that is TE or TM modes. For this purpose, you would recall that we wrote H squared equal to gamma bar squared plus omega squared mu epsilon on one hand, and also in terms of the constants A and B, we had H squared equal to A squared plus B squared, which was further equal to n pi by b whole squared plus m pi by a whole squared. So, in this manner, h squared is related to the order of the mode m or n and the waveguide dimensions. The other parameters are the frequency and the constitutive parameters of the medium filling the interior of the waveguide, and therefore, all these things are coming in into picture, and they will decide the propagation constant gamma bar. We write gamma bar equal to h squared minus omega squared mu epsilon, and therefore, it is m pi by a whole squared plus n pi by b whole squared minus omega squared mu epsilon whole square root. And while in general we said that gamma bar, the propagation constant, can be complex with a real part alpha bar and an imaginary part beta bar, in this idealized situation where we have ignored losses in the conducting walls or in the dielectric medium filling the waveguide, gamma bar would either be completely real below a certain frequency, or it would be completely imaginary above a certain frequency. Okay? We will have for frequencies less than what is called the cutoff frequency, gamma bar going to alpha bar, it will become completely real, and the fields, instead of propagating, will simply decay exponentially as e to the power minus alpha z. Okay? Such a wave is also called an evanescent wave. After a certain distance along the z direction, in this case, the fields will become negligible, as the meaning of the word evanescent would suggest. However, above this cutoff frequency, omega greater than omega c, we'll have gamma bar completely imaginary, and we will have wave propagation without any attendant attenuation, at least in this idealized situation. This is the range of frequencies we are normally interested in. This cutoff frequency can be identified from this expression, these expressions. We have omega c equal to 1 by square root of mu epsilon and then square root of m pi by a whole squared plus n pi by b whole squared and the square root of this whole quantity. Or this is the radian frequency, the frequency in hertz can also be written, it will be replacing 1 by square root of mu epsilon by the velocity of light in the medium filling the waveguide, it will be c by 2 and then we have m by a whole squared plus n by b whole squared and the square root of the quantities involving m and n. So, this is the cutoff frequency which is related to the velocity of light in the medium, in the interior of the waveguide, the order of the modes m and n and the waveguide dimensions. The higher the values of m and n, the higher the corresponding cutoff frequency. Okay. So, from this point of view, now one can appreciate the significance of the fact what is the lowest order mode for the TM or the TE modes. Okay. We said that TM mode has as its lowest order TM11 mode, and then in the TE modes we had TE01 as a possibility and also TE10 as the other possibility. Okay. For TM11, the cutoff frequency will be given by m equal to 1 and n equal to 1. Okay. So, for a given waveguide, the cutoff frequency of this, which we may write as FC11. As far as these expressions are concerned, they are not different for the TM modes or the TE modes. So, we just write FC11, which of course is less than the cutoff frequency corresponding to either of these. Okay. Less than or greater than? It is greater than. For TE01 mode, the cutoff frequency is FC01 and it is equal to C by 2B, quite simply. And the corresponding cutoff frequency for the last one, FC10, is going to be C by 2A. Okay. Now, by convention, A is the dimension along the x direction and B is the dimension along the y direction, and A is taken to be the greater dimension. You could put it in other words, x axis is oriented along the wider dimension of the cross section. Okay. This is almost a universal convention. One or two odd textbooks may use the convention other way round, but normally x is the direction associated with the longer dimension along the cross section. From this, following this convention, now we can see which of these two last cutoff frequencies is greater, and we can easily put this kind of sign. Since A is greater than B, this cutoff frequency is greater than this cutoff frequency. And therefore, we find based on this consideration that it is this mode which has the lowest cutoff frequency. If we are given a waveguide and we start increasing the operating frequency, it is this mode which will start propagating first of all. And as the frequency continues to increase, first this mode may appear, will be supported by the waveguide, and then other modes may appear progressively. So, from that point of view, these other modes which appear later at higher frequencies are called higher order modes, and this becomes the dominant mode, the lowest order mode. Okay, which is an observation of considerable significance. We have already mentioned that normally we like the propagation in a structure to be in a single mode, because if the signal is propagating in a number of modes and these different modes are going to have different characteristics, different field configurations, and as we shall see, different phase velocities, distortion is inevitable. And also the fact that a signal is distributed over a number of modes affects the efficiency of excitation of say the waveguide, and also the efficiency of collection of the power for that particular signal. And therefore, we will prefer that the waveguide or the structure at hand operates in a single mode, and that is possible only for the dominant mode of propagation. Okay. So, what is the lowest order mode, what is the dominant mode for a particular structure is therefore, is a consideration of great significance. The other characteristics of TE and TM modes can now be written down. We have the expression for the phase shift constant in the frequency range greater than omega c, beta bar equal to omega squared mu epsilon minus m pi by a whole squared minus n pi by b whole squared, and of course whole square root. From this expression itself, we can make out that the phase shift constant beta is not a linear function of frequency. Okay. In fact, this is more clear if we write the expression for the phase velocity V p bar, which is going to be omega by beta bar, okay, which is now a function of omega. Unlike the situation for the infinite medium, where these other terms do not appear and we have beta bar equal to square root of omega squared mu epsilon, in that case the phase shift, the phase velocity is going to be constant at all frequencies, but here the phase velocity is not constant with frequency. This is directly a consequence of the fact that the waveguide is not supporting a TEM mode of propagation. Okay. This means that some dispersion is unavoidable. If the phase velocity is a function of frequency, it is different at different frequencies, that is going to lead to dispersion. That precisely is dispersion, and therefore, some dispersion is inevitable, which is again a universal characteristic of TE and TM modes, and therefore, all structures which are not transmission lines. Okay. That is why we have been stressing the fact whether a structure supports TEM mode or not. If it is not a TEM mode of propagation, then the phase velocity is a function of frequency and dispersion, and therefore, related distortion is unavoidable. Okay. As a result of this dispersion, if there is a signal which has a frequency content which spreads too widely, it is likely to get distorted, or else it should be propagated over rather short distances, and therefore, this will have an effect on the bandwidth of the signal that the waveguide can handle, or the distance over which a signal with a certain bandwidth can be propagated. The guide wavelength can also be obtained from here, lambda bar, which is going to be 2 pi by beta bar. And one can make out that just as this is less than omega squared mu epsilon whole square root, this is greater than the velocity of light in the medium filling the interior of the waveguide, and this also is greater than lambda or lambda naught that will be applicable to the interior of the waveguide. Okay. Now, there are two things that I like to point out here as far as the waveguide is concerned. First thing is that as compared to transmission lines, in a waveguide, some dispersion is always present. Okay. That one could say is a disadvantage of using waveguides. We listed a number of advantages of waveguides. There are certain disadvantages also. This is one of those. What could be the other disadvantage? That comes from the fact that for the waveguide to be able to propagate signal at a certain frequency, it must have certain minimum dimensions. Okay. So that the cutoff frequency that the lowest order mode that can be supported on the waveguide is less than the frequency of the signal that we want to transmit. Okay. The cutoff frequency, as we have seen, for even for the lowest order mode FC 10 is equal to C by 2A. Okay. So, if we want to transmit, let us say, a signal of frequency 5 gigahertz, this dimension must have a certain minimum value, okay, which will turn out in centimeters. We shall consider an example and this will become clearer. And therefore, the waveguides are rather bulky, they are not compact. Because they must have certain minimum cross sectional dimensions to be able to propagate signal at a given frequency. Okay. So, these are two disadvantages of the waveguides, and novel structures, transmission structures have been proposed like strip line and transmission line, which at least remove the bulkiness part of the waveguides, but at the cost of something else. Also, these are not easily mass produced. Okay. To produce these in large quantities is not very economical. Okay. But the other structures which may remove some of these limitations will suffer from some other limitations like lower power handling capability and higher attenuation, etcetera. We consider the example of an X-band waveguide and see what kind of cutoff frequencies the waveguide has. The X-band waveguides are used very frequently in laboratories. it has dimensions which are 0.9 by 0.4 inches or 2.286 centimeters by 1.016 centimeters. Okay. The expression for the cutoff frequency has been written earlier. Let me just write down the cutoff frequencies for the modes of various orders. For the T10 mode, the cutoff frequency is 6.55 gigahertz. Okay. And for transmitting signals which are greater than this frequency, this waveguide can be utilized, which is certainly quite large compared to a thin coaxial cable. Okay. So, that supports the statement that waveguides are not very compact. The next mode in the order of increasing cutoff frequencies is TE20 mode, which has a cutoff frequency of 13.1 gigahertz. Then TE10 mode has a cutoff frequency which is 14.01. Thank you. The TE01 mode has a cutoff frequency of 14.78 gigahertz. And then if we go to TE11 or TM11, the cutoff frequency is 16.14 gigahertz. And as we are interested in a single mode of operation over the frequency band over which the waveguide is to be utilized, one can see that if we restrict our signals within the frequency range 8 to let us say 12 gigahertz, then we will maintain single mode of operation. The other modes will be above cutoff, the waveguide will not support these, okay, which is the X band frequency, X band frequency range. So, in the lecture today, we have considered the field expressions for the TM, MN and the TE, MN modes. We have considered the characteristics of these modes and we considered the example of an X band waveguide. So, this is where we stop this lecture. Thank you.